I'd like to introduce you to a Cuban citizen with a passion for human rights, a love of technology, but extremely limited internet access. Despite these odds, she's helped to facilitate change in Cuba. She's been recognized outside of her country, finally catching the attention of global leaders, including Presidents Carter and Obama. First, a little history.
It is clear that this nation must take an ever closer and more realistic look at the menace of external communist intervention and domination in Cuba.
For over 50 years, the U.S. and Cuba have been locked in a seemingly unending stalemate that has led to some of the most tense moments in modern history. But a new era is about to begin.
Today, the United States of America is changing its relationship with the people of Cuba.
There's a complicated history between the United States and Cuba. I was born in 1961, just over 2 years after Fidel Castro took power in Cuba. We're separated by just over 90 miles. But year after year, an ideological and economic barrier hardened between our two countries. Meanwhile, the Cuban exile community in the United States made enormous contributions to our country in politics, in business, culture, and sports. Like immigrants before, Cubans helped remake America, even as they felt a painful yearning for the land and families they left behind. All of this bound America and Cuba in a unique relationship, at once family and foe. Proudly, the United States has supported democracy and human rights in Cuba through these 5 decades. We've done so primarily through policies that aim to isolate the island, preventing the most basic travel and commerce that Americans can enjoy anyplace else.
We're the Cube of graces and the secret places that no world can fill. With our hands on her hips, oh, and that smile on her lips, because she knows that it kills me. With a stop and scream standing in that doorway like a dream, I wish she'd just leave me alone. Because French dream won't stop, and them boots and French kisses will not break that heart of stone. With her long hair falling and her eyes that shine like the midnight sun. Oh, she's the one.
Unfortunately, our sanctions on Cuba have denied Cubans access to technology that has empowered individuals around the globe. So I've authorized increased telecommunications connections between the United States and Cuba. Businesses will be able to sell goods that enable Cubans to communicate with the United States. And the embargo that's been imposed for decades is now codified in legislation. As these changes unfold, I look forward to engaging Congress in an honest and serious debate about lifting the embargo. I made clear my strong belief that Cuban society is constrained by restrictions on its citizens. We welcome Cuba's decision to provide more access to the internet for its citizens and to continue increasing engagement with international institutions like the United Nations and the International Committee of the Red Cross that promote universal values. But I'm under no illusion about the continued barriers to freedom that remain for ordinary Cubans. The United States believes that no Cuban should face harassment or arrest or beatings simply because they're exercising a universal right to have their voices heard. And we will continue to support civil society there. While Cuba has made reforms to gradually open up its economy, we continue to believe that Cuban workers should be free to form unions, just as their citizens should be free to participate in the political process. Moreover, given Cuba's history, I expect it will continue to pursue foreign policies that will at times be sharply at odds with American interests. I do not expect the changes I'm announcing today to bring about a transformation of Cuban society overnight, but I am convinced that through a policy of engagement, we can more effectively.
No te lo puedo negar, se me sale la babita.